Thank you for listening to Depictions Media Radio.
Welcome to Policy and Rights, the show about government policy and human rights. Welcome back to Policy and Rights here in Depictions Media Radio. I'm your host, Michael Cloggs. Well, Mr. Poirier didn't get his way. The Quebec Bloc Party stepped up and said that they would not vote for non-confidence against the Liberal government, thus keeping the Liberal government in place in at least until election time comes around again. So we're going to hear the question and answer period on the rhetoric debate between Justin Trudeau and Pierre Poilievre as they continue to debate. Hey, Justin Trudeau is the most expensive Prime Minister in history, versus, well, it's just rhetoric and no plan for the Conservative government. Again, leading back to what I've been saying all along, that Canada needs a plan. And as we're looking at the election in the United States, with Mr. Trump making accusations, and the Vice President Kamala Harris, as she does try to put policy in place, and as we head into the last few weeks of that election campaign, that we need to look at seriously at some of the anti-racism bills that Kamala Harris helped put together and send up for a vote. We also need to look at the ghost gun policy that was developed using a lot of her research and know-how as a prosecutor to send that those motions into law so that ghost guns can no longer be legal or be legally attained in the United States. There are other things that she has done that actually push forward women's health care in her history, and that those sort of things need to be taken account for and pushed forward as folks head into the polls to vote for the next president of the United States. Back to Canada, we're also going to hear from a news conference about Jasper. As Jasper, Alberta, as we know, during the summer had a massive fire. Heard from one particular was witness on a train as the train was sent backwards the train did get close to the flames, and the tracks were impassable. The station was impassable because of the fire damage that was actually done to Jasper. It is a Canadian treasure for one, the ice fields that developed there, and as a national park and a mountain community, that the glaciers and the tourism that actually goes through there are an important, very important gem to Western Canada and the western part of North America. The wildlife that is there, as like driving through myself, seeing the number of bear, the moose, actually finally saw a moose up close and personal in Jasper for the first time when I saw one. It's like what a majestic sight to see such a grand animal. And even the animals for the time being are displaced as nature tries to recover. And of course, our human communities need to be rebuilt so that people can come visit and experience the majesty of nature. So, we also need to move forward. We aren't going to actually get to listen to, we don't have a recording ready for the press conference that Antonio Guterres, the Secretary General of the United Nations, had before the next UN General Assembly. It would be the 79th General Assembly for the United Nations. And Mr. Guterres had a press conference where he talked about some of the importance of the General Assembly and the United Nations. He said that the summit of the future is essential first step towards making global institutions more legitimate, effective, and fit for the world of today and tomorrow. The United Nations chief emphasized the critical role of the summit of the future as it was born out of cold, hard fact. International challenges are moving faster than our ability to solve them. Guterres also says that many of the challenges the world faces today were not on the radar 80 years ago when the multilateral institutions were born. The founders of the UN understood that times would change, he emphasizes, and adding through values that the global institutions are timeless. The institutions themselves cannot be frozen in time. Guterres said, like our founders, we cannot precisely know what the future holds, but we don't need a crystal ball to see that 21st century challenges require global problem-solving mechanisms that are more effective, networked, and inclusive. That serious power imbalances in the global institutions must be adjusted and updated, and that our institutions must draw on the expertise and representation of all humanity. The challenge will not be overnight, he says, but will start today. He also goes on to say, when we look at the work that was done already in preparations for the summit of future, we see a movement in the right direction. Guterres noted a strong language of the Security Council reform in a generation and set the governance measures for technologies, including artificial intelligence, a major advance in reform of international financial architecture, a step change in financing the sustainable development of goals, and a commitment to advance the SDG stimulus, multiplying the resources available to developing countries. Simply put, the United Nations is, in comparison to the world, that it still has systematically left out an entire continent of countries. Africa is dramatically underrepresented and has the fewest number of permanent representatives in the United Nations to date. The UN Security Council does not have near enough African votes to talk about issues that are part of that continent, and also as a result part of our global community. When we look at certain things that are going on with the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Sudan, and other communities that have either been devastated by violence or natural disaster and are slow to come back around again, it is because of some of the resources that are limited to them because they are not generally recognized as prominent as, say, the United States, the Russian Federation, or other countries that are definitely a part of the United Nations Security Council and other institutions that are deep-set into the United Nations. So, Mr. Guerra, I wish him luck in making positive changes so that African nations and other underdeveloped nations in South America can also be part of that table that helps form a earthly community, a human community of the future as our 21st century pushes forward. So why don't we move forward with today's segments, as we're going to go to the question and answer period, where we hear rhetoric and debate between Mr. Poilievre and Mr. Trudeau. And we're also going to hear what is new and happening from Jasper, what the federal government is actually trying to accomplish, and we'll hear more about immigration into Canada as refugees from, once again, back to Africa and South America try to seek asylum in Canada for a better, what they think is going to be a better life. So here we go, question answer period first.
Oral question.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition. We've just learned that the Bloc will be voting to keep the most costly Prime Minister and most centralizing Prime Minister in history in power. A government that's doubled the cost of housing, doubled the national debt, increased the cost of groceries, broken our immigration system, pushing Quebec to the breaking point. How can the Bloc abandon Quebecers to prop up this prime minister, the most costly and centralizing one in our country's history. The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Once again, Mr. Speaker, we see the Leader of the Opposition is only concerned about his own political interests and not the interests of Canadians and Quebecers. That's why we're going to keep investing in Canadians. We're going to be there for Quebecers with health care, dental care, more child care places, instead of proposing cuts and austerity, which we know the Conservative Leader would impose on everyone. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition. Canadians' interest is in cutting taxes, building houses, fixing the budget, and stopping crime so that Quebecers can bring home bigger paychecks and pensions that will be enough to afford housing and food. That's after 9 years of the Liberal Bloc coalition. They've doubled the debt, double the cost of living, and broken our immigration system. Why is the Bloc propping up this expensive and centralizing government? The Honourable Prime Minister. Once again, we see the Conservative Leader believes in slogans, but not in Canadians and Quebecers. He doesn't want to invest to help people with dental care. He doesn't want to be there to help our seniors, to help young people. He just wants to cut programs. He voted against our climate action, against checks that people need, but he wants nothing to do with that. He's obsessed with his own thirst for power. We're concerned about Quebecers and Canadians, and we're working for them.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
The NDP leader sold out Canadians to sign onto a costly coalition that doubled the debt, doubled the housing costs, sent 2 million people to food banks and 1,800 tent encampments. He voted 24 times for the carbon tax. And since he did his dramatic video, he has refused to answer 40 times whether he'd vote non-confidence. Now that he knows that the Bloc is going to keep the Liberals in power, he'll stand up and claim that he's voting against. Mr. Speaker, why won't the NDP stand up when it counts so that we can end this costly coalition and elect a common sense government?
Before the Prime Minister takes the call, I'm going to ask the Honourable Member from New Westminster, Burnaby, please, to only take the microphone when his voice is recognized. The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, once again, we see that the Leader of the Opposition enjoys his political games, enjoys chasing after his own political interests, and has not a second to care for Canadians' interests. He's actually in a bad mood because inflation has come down for Canadians. He doesn't care about their interests. That's why we're going to continue to deliver for Canadians. We're going to continue to step up with investments that are going to support Canadians, fight climate change, and build a brighter future for everyone.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, after 9 years of this costly NDP carbon tax coalition, what's happened? What's up? Taxes up, costs up, crimes up, time's up. What Canadians need is hope. By choosing a common sense government that axes taxes, builds homes, fixes the budget, and stops the crime so they can earn powerful paychecks and pensions that buy affordable food, gas, and homes in safe neighborhoods protected by a strong military. Why can't we bring it home now?
Yeah. The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Because that little performance shows just how much the Leader of the Opposition loves his slogans, but actually doesn't put forward any.
I'm going to ask, as I'd asked a previous member before, to please not take the floor unless they're recognized. I'm going to ask all members, please, to allow the member to. I'll ask the Prime Minister, Right Honourable Prime Minister, to start from the top.
Boy, Mr. Speaker, point out the performance of the Leader of the Opposition and his colleagues get all upset because they know that he doesn't actually care about Canadians. He doesn't care about the programs we're delivering. He doesn't care about stepping up to support Canadians. He's actually in a bad mood because inflation has come down to 2%, Mr. Speaker, and it ruins his little just inflation slogan. He is so upset because he's cared about his own interests and not the interests of Canadians. We're going to stay focused on the things that matter for people while he spins little
if anyone had any doubt, it's definitely Wednesday. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, the just inflation tagline works now better than ever. After he can try to call himself Rocky Balboa and play fight songs to aggrandize himself as the star. But the people lined up at food banks, 2 million of them every month, know better. The people who are living in the 1,800 Ontario tent encampments know better. The 35 homeless encampments in Halifax, the people there know better. They know that we need to fire this costly carbon tax coalition so we can elect a common sense government that will bring it home for them.
Yeah. The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, he sure loves to declaim about vulnerable people and perform his empathetic supposed concern. But the reality is he is using vulnerable people for his own political gains. If he actually cared about people, he wouldn't have voted against dental care for 700,000 seniors. He wouldn't have voted against a child food school food policy that's helping families with $800 worth of groceries a year. He's not making the investments in Canadians. He wants to cut programs, make Canadians suffer, so he can sit in the big chair.
Order.
Order. Then I have
the Honourable Member for Belle Chambly. The Prime Minister appointed a special envoy to fight Islamophobia, and she felt that her terms of reference included criticizing Quebec's universities for not providing for student security. Perhaps we don't see Islamophobia in the same way, because some would say that this position is, strictly speaking, a liberal activist and political position. So I'd like to ask the Prime Minister, what is his definition of Islamophobia? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, this government recognized that there was a rise in intolerance of all kinds all across the country, and we had a duty to recognize that and fight against it. That's why we appointed a special representative against Islamophobia and also a special rep against anti-Semitism. And we also recognize systemic discrimination in our institutions. So we have lots of challenges to face in bringing Canadians together and in addressing our challenges together to create a more peaceful and respectful country, the country that we now have. The Honourable Member for Belle Chambly. This is no small thing. The Prime Minister does not know the definition of Islamophobia. Does he think that without a definition, criticizing Quebec universities reduces Islamophobia somehow? Or does it rather polarize Canadians and pit them against one another? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, as the member opposite knows full well, I am a proud Quebecer, and I am proud that the Liberal Party of Canada has more Quebec members than the Bloc Québécois does. So we are proud Canadians, proud Quebecers, and we know that in every institution all across country there are challenges around racism, systemic discrimination, and so on, and we need to address those issues, and that's the work we're doing, because we know everyone should feel included and respected within our country, and unfortunately, we're seeing a rise in intolerance all across the country, so it's our duty, all of our duties, to come together and listen to one another. The Honourable Member for Rosemont-La-Petite-Patrie. Mr. Speaker, all over the country, conservative governments are privatizing our health care. They want people to have to pay to see a doctor, and it's no different in Quebec. But this Prime Minister is too weak to stand up to the Conservatives. And the people are the ones paying the price. What's it going to take for him to stand up to defend the principles of universal public health care? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, we all know that the NDP is concerned about progressive values all across the country, but they can't deliver the goods. We were happy to work with them to deliver concrete things in health care, in child care for Canadians, but unfortunately, they're the ones who decided to stop delivering the goods for Canadians. Progressive things are not always easy to accomplish, but we will continue fighting to do so. We will continue to defend our public health care system, and we will keep investing in the Canadian system. But unfortunately, the NDP can't say the same.
The Honourable Member for Cowichan-Malahat-Langford.
They are failing on health care and they are failing on groceries because 1 year ago today, the Liberals met with Canada's grocery CEOs and promised to stabilize prices. A year later, prices are still up. Grocery CEOs are still gouging families, struggling to put food on the table. Meanwhile, the Conservatives remain silent on grocery greed, and they want to give even more taxpayer money to these CEOs. Canadians are fed up, they are working harder and falling further behind. Why does this Prime Minister keep caving to CEOs while Canadians pay the price?
Hear, hear! Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Unfortunately, the NDP is taking a page out of the Conservative playbook and choosing slogans rather than the hard work that will actually help Canadians. Right. We've delivered some of the most comprehensive reforms to the Competition Act in order to hold big grocers account for the work that they're doing in terms of delivering for Canadians. We've also moved forward on a national school food program that's putting more food in the bellies of 400,000 kids across the country as provinces come on board, and is going to save parents up to $800 on their grocery bills. These are things tangibly that we're busy delivering while they're playing politics.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
April 30th, 2014. Life in Canada, home of the world's most affluent middle class, the New York Times. Yet, today, almost a decade after that NDP Liberal Prime Minister has been in what he calls the big chair, Canada's GDP per capita is actually down, while the American one is up 19%. His carbon taxes are strangling growth. How could the solution possibly be to quadruple the tax to 61 cents a liter and send more jobs and businesses south?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
We know the Leader of the Opposition doesn't believe in climate change and doesn't believe in putting more money in the pockets of Canadians with a Canada carbon rebate. How many wildfires, hurricanes, droughts are going to go after Canadians' lives and livelihoods before he understands you can't have a plan for the economy unless you have a plan for the environment?
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
He doesn't have a plan for either, as evidenced by the fact that he came completely unglued and started spitting out personal insults and crying, liar, 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 on a radio station the other day when he learned that I had pointed to his own government report, which showed that his carbon tax will blow a $25 to $30 billion hole in our GDP. This was from a report that his government tabled in the House of Commons. If, in fact, his government is lying about the true cost of the carbon tax to our economy, then what is the true cost?
Yeah. The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the Parliamentary Budget Officer demonstrated that 8 out of 10 Canadian families do better with the Canada carbon rebate every 3 months than the cost of the price on pollution. And on top of that, Canadians know the price on pollution has brought down our emissions faster than any other G7 country at the same time as it is supporting Canadians in the middle class and working hard to join it. We're going to continue to fight climate change and invest in a strong economy for the future while the Leader of the Opposition continues to deny climate change and cut programs and services that Canadians rely on.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, you can't sit in the big chair if you can't read your own government documents. Environment and Climate Change Canada carbon pollution pricing data tabled in this House by his government said that it will cost between $25 and $30 billion in lost GDP when this tax is implemented. A further document tabled by his environment minister on carbon tax 2 says there will be another $9 billion hole for a total of between $34 and $40 billion. Now he screams that this is all lies. Again, if his government documents are lying, what is the true cost of the carbon tax to our economy?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, every Canadian, except perhaps the Canadians in the Conservative Party of Canada, understand that the costs of inaction on climate change will be catastrophic, not just with wildfires, droughts, floods, hurricanes, but with lost economic opportunity, lost jobs, lost growth for Canadians as we solve the challenges of the 21st century. We are choosing to invest in a strong economy for the future. We're choosing to fight climate change and develop the solutions of the world's going to need to do that, while the Leader of the Opposition offers a do-nothing climate change plan that will cost Canadians billions.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
His carbon tax has not stopped a single flood, or single fire in this country. He's not stopped any natural disasters. What he has done is driven Canadians into poverty, quadrupling the tax to 61 cents a liter will cause a nuclear winter for our economy. Something that his carbon tax coalition partners in the NDP have voted to bring about. So if he really is so confident in a 61 cent a liter tax, why doesn't he call a carbon tax election and let Canadians decide?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, the problem with the Leader of the Opposition is he believes in slogans. He just doesn't believe in climate change. The fact is, our plan to fight climate change is not just putting more money in the pockets of 8 out of 10 Canadians across the country, but is bringing down emissions and creating jobs and opportunity for Canadians for generations to come. His climate change denialism, his do-nothing plan to fight climate change is going to hurt Canadians. We are going to continue to build a strong economy for the future because we know fighting climate change is part of it.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
But he's not fighting climate change. He's driving production out of Canada to more polluting for foreign jurisdictions rather than our common sense plan to green-like green projects that produce more energy around the world that displace emissions. That's a common sense approach. And he still won't answer the question, though, on the full cost of his two carbon taxes. I've cited government documents tabled in this House that say that it will total between $34 and $40 billion per year in lost GDP and jobs. If his government documents are wrong, then what is the true loss of GDP as a result of his 61 cent a liter carbon tax?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, he talks about driving investment out of Canada. He must be remembering his own time as minister. Because since 2016, Mr. Speaker, foreign direct investment is up 60% in this country. Last year, we were third in the world after the U.S. and Brazil, which makes us number one for foreign investment in the G20 per capita. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, we are continuing to show the world that they can have confidence in Canada and in Canadians. Why doesn't he have confidence in Canadians? Why won't he invest in Canada?
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, the Deputy Governor of the Bank of Canada said of Canada's investment problems, emergency break glass. Canadian workers get 55 cents of investment for every dollar American workers get, and only 65 cents for every dollar that an OECD worker gets. The gap between the Canadian and U.S. economy is now at a 100-year high after 9 years of the NDP Liberal. So one last time, his own documents show that his 61 cent a liter carbon tax will blow a $40 billion hole in our economy. If that number's not right, what is the real number?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, once again we see that the Leader of the Opposition is frustrated that international economists, climate experts, academics all back our plan to both fight climate change and grow a strong economy, while he's stuck with late-night far-right conspiracy YouTube videos. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, we are delivering concretely to build a stronger future for Canadians, to fight climate change and to grow the economy, while he is hiding his head in the sand and refusing to admit even that climate change is real.
The Honourable Member for Belleuil-Chambly. A unanimous motion by the Quebec Assembly that education comes under Quebec's exclusive jurisdiction and hiring professors should be based on merit and certainly not based on religion. They reiterate that hiring based on religion is not only discriminatory, but it goes against state secularism. And the National Assembly repeats its request to have the special envoy on Islamophobia fired. I'd just like to remind all members, I know there was a lot of content in that question, and it's difficult for our interpreters to interpret all of that. And so we should speak at a speed that's reasonable for our interpreters, Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, let me be crystal clear. The universities have to hire the best possible people for the job. That's their job. But we also recognize that universities have policies that they've put in place to ensure that their staff reflect the diversity of the communities they serve. So I have full confidence in our universities, and we must always keep fighting systemic discrimination in all our institutions from coast to coast to coast. The Honourable Member for Belleuil-Chambly. Does it take 9 years to learn not to answer questions? The National Assembly of Quebec unanimously said that your person has insulted all of us. We're calling for her resignation. Are you on Ms. Gawabi's position against Quebec? Are you on her side and against the National Assembly of Quebec with all its elected representatives? If not, let it be known. The Right Honourable Prime Minister. To suggest in this place that a member from Quebec, elected by Quebecers, does not represent his constituents is an insult to this very place, and the Bloc, which was elected to this place, should be ashamed of saying such a thing. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
2000 to 2014, Canadians attracted $30 to $100 billion more of American investment than the reverse. In the last 9 years of this NDP Liberal government, there have been $450 billion more Canadian dollars invested in the U.S. than the return. That's Canadian money building U.S. pipelines, U.S. mines, U.S. businesses paying American workers with Canadian money. That is the consequence of a high carbon tax and a high energy price that drives jobs away. When will the Prime Minister learn that his radical plan to hike the tax to 61 cents a litre will destroy our economy further?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
The problem with that argument, Mr. Speaker, is that the Leader of the Opposition doesn't understand that the International Monetary Fund and others have projected Canada to have stronger growth than the United States next year, despite the fact that we have a price on pollution, or perhaps because of the fact we have a price on pollution that is drawing in investment from around the world in the growing sectors of the economy to ensure good jobs in mining, in environmental research, in various industries, because we know the future is greener.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
our per capita GDP is smaller than it was 10 years ago, perhaps the first time since the Great Depression that that has happened. He's had the worst economic growth since the Depression. The OECD says that Canada will have the worst economic growth this year and for the next three decades. Our economy has dropped more per capita since before COVID than any other G7 country. Insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. This Prime Minister wants to quadruple the carbon tax to 61 cents a liter, which will be an economic catastrophe for this country.
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, what that little performance just showed is that the Leader of the Opposition is using his brokenest argument around Canada to explain why he would cut dental programs, cut child care, step away from any climate action, withdraw support to draw in investment. That's his excuse. The problem with that argument, however, Mr. Speaker, is Canada actually has the strongest fiscal position of any of the world's advanced economies, and our choice is putting that strong fiscal position in service of investment in Canadians, in dental, in child care, in pharma, in...
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
There he goes again, telling Canadians they've never had it so good. It's never been so good for those 2 million people lined up at food banks. For the 1 million people every month that go to food banks in Ontario, record-smashing increases in homelessness by his own admission, after he promised a food program that hasn't delivered a single meal despite millions spent on bureaucracy, 1 in 4 kids line up at food banks. And now, the worst. He proposes to quadruple the carbon taxes on heat, housing, fuel, and food. How much will that take from our GDP?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the problem that he will not talk of, the problem he has is that he cannot admit that the price on pollution puts more money back in the pockets of middle-class Canadians and those working hard to join it. He continues to spew the line that Canada is broken, and whenever I point out that we have a strong fiscal balance sheet that we should be putting in service of programs and supports for Canadians, he says, no, we need cuts. That is not the path forward for Canada, and that's the choice Canadians get to make. Do we go with austerity and cuts to programs, or do we invest in Canadians and their future?
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Canadians who can't eat, heat, or house themselves are living in austerity now. And as to his false PMO talking point about 8 out of 10 Canadians being better off, it conveniently excludes the $25 billion per year in economic costs that his own government admits that the carbon tax imposes on Canadians. And that's why 6 in 10 Canadian families and 100% of the middle class are worse off with his carbon tax. So his documents show Canadians are worse off. If he doesn't have confidence in his own government documents, how can this House have confidence in his government?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Millions of Canadians across the country have received the Canada carbon rebate checks that puts more money in their pockets every 3 months than it costs them on average on the price on pollution. That allows us not only to fight climate change and boost our economy in strong ways that create the innovative solutions that the world is going to increasingly rely on, but it helps Canadians with affordability at a challenging time. He would eliminate those Canada carbon rebate checks and put forward no plan to fight climate change. That's not how you build the future for Canada.
The Honourable Member from Winnipeg Centre.
Mr. Speaker, under the Liberals, housing prices in Winnipeg are out of control. The average rent for a one-bedroom suite in Winnipeg increased over 22% since last year, the largest jump in the country. Corporate landlords are buying up affordable housing and jacking up rents because they know they have support of both the Liberals and the Conservatives. Well, I can tell you one thing, Mr. Speaker, they are not the answer to our housing crisis. So my question to the Prime Minister, why is he allowing corporate landlords to price people out of their homes?
Here, here, here.
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I very much look forward to working with the NDP Premier of Manitoba on Renters' Bill of Rights. We just presented a number of measures that will directly help renters, like ensuring that rent is counted towards calculation of credit scores so people can get a mortgage, by protecting renters from landlords. We recognize, as I'm sure do the NDP, that that is largely a provincial jurisdiction, but I'm very glad to hear that the Premier of NDP, the NDP Premier of Manitoba will be stepping up to work with the federal government on delivering for Canadians in Manitoba and indeed right across the country.
Here, here. The Honourable Member from Edmonton Griesbach.
What is in provincial jurisdiction is what's happening in Edmonton Griesbach, where the federal government is set to bulldoze hundreds of homes in my community so that developers get rich. These homes are on public land and are some of the last affordable units in my city due to decades of Liberal and Conservative cuts. Families like Kim's, a single mom raising a child with a family with a member of a disability, is scared she will be homeless. Will the Prime Minister stop the dem evictions, stop selling off land to rich developers, and build the homes that people can actually afford?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, our government put forward one of the most ambitious investments in housing that this country has ever seen. We are happy to work hand-in-hand with the NDP to make sure that public lands get used for affordable housing, that we're doing everything we can to push back against provinces that are attacking a public affordability of homes. We would very much like to continue working with the NDP on this matter. They're choosing to play politics with the Conservatives and put politics first. We're going to continue to work to make sure that his residents in Edmonton, Griesbach, and indeed right across the country, get better affordability, better homes, because that's what this federal government is focused on. Not
Bonjour, good afternoon everyone. Mon nom est Stephen Guilbeault, je suis ministre de l'Environnement et du Changement climatique. Très heureux d'être ici et merci de vous joindre à nous. Je suis accompagné de mes collègues et amis, le ministre Arjit Sajjan, ministre de la de réponse aux urgences, le ministre Randy Boissonneau, ainsi que Andrew Campbell, de vice-président de Parc Canada, qui pourra répondre à vos questions plus techniques. I would like to start by acknowledging that the land on which we gather today is on the traditional and unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe people, who have lived on these lands since time immemorial. Jasper residents and local businesses owners continue to face the effects of the wildfire that devastated the municipality of Jasper and Jasper National Park almost 2 months ago. In July, I saw with my own eyes the incredible devastation, but also the incredible spirit of cooperation and resiliency from Jasperites. En juillet, j'ai eu l'occasion de visiter Jasper et j'ai constaté de mes yeux la destruction causée par le feu de forêt. La hausse des températures moyennes qui crée des conditions plus sèches et des feux de forêt plus intenses sont une des démonstrations de l'impact des changements climatiques. Les pompiers ont accompli un travail héroïque en évacuant 25 000 personnes en 5 heures et sauvant 70 % des bâtiments dans la municipalité. Près de 30 % des structures ont été détruites ou grandement endommagées. Now the community is recovering and rebuilding, and they need our help. That's why today, in the House of Commons, the Government of Canada introduced a bill entitled An Act to Amend the Canada National Parks Act. This important legislation would begin the transfer of land use planning and development authorities from Parks Canada to the municipality of Jasper and help ensure streamlined decision-making where locally elected officials are empowered to make decisions regarding their community. This puts those important decisions of the rebuild of Jasper squarely back into the hands where it belongs, in the community, with close support and collaboration from Parks Canada. Following the devastating wildfire in July, our government made this a legislative priority for the first week of the parliamentary session. By enabling the transfer of planning and development authorities to the municipality, it will make it possible to give the town of Jasper businesses and residents more say to shape the future of the town. We're committed to remove any and all barriers that impede these efforts. Le projet de loi que nous avons déposé est un pas important pour démontrer l'engagement de notre gouvernement pour supporter la communauté et les commerces locaux dans le parc national pour les aider à reconstruire au cours des prochaines années. Au cours des prochaines semaines et mois, nous allons continuer de travailler étroitement avec la municipalité de Jasper et l'ensemble des intervenants. L'objectif est d'assurer une utilisation efficace de l'espace, de garantir la conservation de l'environnement, de minimiser l'étalement urbain, tout en maximisant les possibilités économiques, sociales et communautaires. Parc travaille main dans la main avec la municipalité depuis 2022 pour établir les approches pour le partage de ses responsabilités. C'est aussi une étape clé pour garantir que les décisions importantes à Jasper relèvent de la municipalité et de la population. Many of us have been lucky at one time or another to have visited Jasper and witnessed the majestic beauty of the town and its surrounding countryside. Rebuilding isn't easy, but step by step, we will get there. Together, we will rebuild Jasper back to being a beautiful mountain community in a national park that meets the needs of local residents, business owners, and visitors from all around the world. I think all members of Parliament can agree to the importance of this work, regardless of political stripes. That's why I'm urging all members of the House of Commons to stand with us to support Jasperites. Thank you. Merci beaucoup. I did forget to introduce Mayor Richard Ireland, who's with us virtually. We can see him on screen. My apologies, Richard, but he's here sir, with us.
You go.
Arch. Okay.
Thank you, Stephen. Thank you. I just want to take this opportunity to give a just to remind Canadians on the impact that climate change has had on our country. And sadly, the community of Jasper was a victim of this this year. And we've seen the devastating impact of climate change and wildfire as a result of what's taken place. But at the same time, I want to reiterate just the brave action that was taken during Jasper and the cooperation that was taking place at all levels of government, all the different agencies, especially within the Unified Command, that actually saved majority of Jasper. And they deserve the credit for what they did. And especially Parks Canada for the amazing work, the Unified Command that took place, the Heavy Urban Search and Rescue Team out of Calgary, CAN Task Force 2, and the Alberta Wildfire Service. I do want to also stress that Jasper was probably the most fire smart community in the country. And there are also training exercises that were also conducted in the previous years that resulted in the amazing coordination work that actually took place. And the reason I want to mention this is because it takes significant effort to making sure that we're going to deal with the effects of climate change as we move forward. And during that time, and I had the opportunity to drive with Mayor Ireland to Jasper during that time, also with the Premier and many other folks of ministers within and MLAs from the Alberta government. And one of the things we committed to is making sure that we're going to deliver for the community of Jasper. And that's exactly what we did. We were on the phone almost immediately with folks, removing red tape very quickly. And that's what today is about working together to making sure that we can move as quickly as possible and do the rebuild of Jasper. But once again, I just want to take this opportunity to thank all the brave firefighters for their amazing work for what they did, and also just remind Canadians that it does come at a loss that we did lose one firefighter who was battling the flames in Jasper at this time. So again, we'll continue to work together. There's a lot more work to do, and then a lot of good lessons out of Jasper will be talked about and work together across the country. Thank you. Over to you, Randy.
Thanks, Arch. Merci, Stephen. Merci, Arch. Andrew, toujours un plaisir. Mayor, your worship, thanks for joining us today. Chers amis, les gens de Jasper ont besoin de nous. Ils ont besoin de leur gouvernement fédéral. Ils ont besoin qu'on mobilise comme Parlement pour les appuyer. Point à la ligne. What Minister Guilbeault and Minister Gould put on the table on the floor of the House today is a bill that will provide equity to Jasperites. What do I mean by that? It's going to put into Mayor Ireland and his council's hands the ability to fast-track the permitting and really remove any vestige of red tape as a comes to Jasper rebuilding and beyond that. Banff already has these abilities. It had taken some time to get Jasper to that point, but as Stephen said, these conversations started in 2022, and the ability to have these municipal permitting and the ability to manage municipal lands is critical inside the park. Banff has demonstrated that mayor and council know how to do this work, and we want to equip Mayor Ireland and his councillors with the ability to do that. Why? Because we want to rebuild Jasper quickly, efficiently, safely. And to do that, we want to make sure that we put in Mayor Ireland's hands all of the powers he can have as a municipality, governed by the Municipal Governance Act in the government of Alberta and following all the rules and regulations that apply. But we need to give Mayor Ireland the flexibility he needs to get Jasperites back on their feet. And I want to thank Harge and your team and the swift work that you did in your role as Minister of Emergency Preparedness. Like, you worked very closely with Minister Lowen, with Minister Ellis, with the Premier, and I have been now twice to the Unified Command. It was something to behold. Andrew, I think you and I were both there twice. Stephen, you and I were there once. And to see everybody rowing in the same direction, regardless of where they come from, and Parks Canada personnel from every corner of this country leaning in and demonstrating what it means to stick up for a community that was devastated, losing 30% of its buildings, a disproportionate effect on the residents, and now they need parliamentarians to row in the same direction. We need every single party to give us unanimous consent so that we can get this bill over the line, turn it into law, and give Mayor Ireland the powers that he needs to support Jasper. This is an important step along the road to rebuilding. We're going to rebuild Jasper better than ever before. As a former minister of tourism, I can say, and as a kid growing up in Alberta and Edmonton, Jasper was our closest national park. I remember going with my grandparents to Jasper. I remember being in Whistler Campground. We didn't have a lot of money. We had tents. And then we upgraded to like a tent trailer, and we thought we won the lottery. And quite frankly, those are the memories that I want for future generations. I want Jasper back. It is a gem in the crown of our national parks. It is our second most popular park, largest by landmass. We owe it to Mayor Ireland, Jasperites, and the world to bring Jasper back. Donc, mes chers collègues, aujourd'hui c'est critique. On a le consentement unanime demain de nos collègues pour augmenter et donner les pouvoirs au maire Ireland et ses conseillers de faire tout le travail qu'ils peuvent pour rebâtir Jasper. Le gouvernement fédéral va être à leur côté. On a besoin du Parlement pour approuver ce projet de loi dès que possible. And with that, I'd like to turn over to His Worship Mayor Richard Ireland.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you very much, Minister Boisseneau, for that kind introduction. And thank you, Minister and Ministers Guilbeault and Sajjan, for your previous visits to Jasper and for your continuing support. It really is appreciated. On behalf of the entire community of Jasper, I want to take this opportunity to thank the federal government for today's really significant initiative. As a municipality, we have always valued the opportunity to increase our role in planning and development in a manner, of course, consistent with our unique form of shared jurisdiction with our federal partners. That partnership has been instrumental in shaping the Jasper that we know today, a community deeply rooted in its national park heritage. Today, we so welcome a legislative change that will set the stage to allow us to take on greater responsibilities in land use planning and development. This is a tremendously significant step forward for Jasper, and it comes, as you know, at an absolutely crucial time for our community. As you all know, this summer's wildfires have severely tested our resilience. But now, with this legislative support, we are in a much stronger position to continue our work with Parks Canada to recover, rebuild, and restore our beloved community and its surrounding natural and built environment. The changes which this legislation enables will permit us to plan for Jasper's future with more local input, ensuring that decisions made truly reflect the needs of our residents, while of course preserving the unique character of our iconic national park. And together we can rebuild a stronger, more sustainable community. So I really do appreciate this initiative. I appreciate so much this opportunity to join you here today.
So this afternoon we have Mark Miller, the Minister of Immigration, Refugees and Citizenship, and the Honourable Randy Boisneau, the Minister of Employment, and they are here to make an announcement about strengthening our temporary resident programs and migration pathways. I'll leave it to you guys. Thank you so much. Over to you.
Thanks, Jean-Paul. Thanks, everyone, for being with us today. Merci tout le monde de votre attention. J'aimerais juste commencer en nous situant au tout début de la pandémie. On avait proposé des changements, des mesures temporaires pour protéger les travailleurs, inspirer de la confiance et stimuler la croissance dans un contexte de stagnation économique et d'incertitude internationale. And so what we did is we accelerated hiring, we created jobs, we supported Canada's small businesses, and it also meant that we brought in more temporary foreign workers. And we welcomed those temporary foreign workers to fill hundreds of thousands of job vacancies. Coming out of the pandemic, we had a million job vacancies, and the entire ecosystem was asking us to bring in more workers so we could jumpstart the economy. We did that. Now we're closer to 500,000 job vacancies, and you have heard the Prime Minister, you've heard me on this matter, and now Canada's fully recovered from the pandemic. We have the strongest economy in the G7. Foreign direct investment per capita is tops in the world. And so what we're doing today is making sure that the measures that we introduced stick and that we actually reflect today's economic realities. So j'étais très clair. Le programme de travailleurs étrangers temporaires a toujours été et sera toujours utilisé comme un dernier recours, une mesure de dernier recours pour combler les postes vacants. Il ne s'agit pas d'un outil pour les travailleurs de remplacer les employeurs de remplacer les travailleurs canadiens ou supprimer leur salaire. So, in English, let me state that I've always been clear that the temporary foreign worker program is and has always been a last resort measure and should never be used to replace Canadian workers who want the jobs, and it should not be used to suppress their wages. And so, last month, the PM was clear and announced changes to the temporary foreign worker program, and those changes will come into effect September 26th. And I want to just review them because it's going to be important for the substance of my comments today. So these changes included reducing the cap from 20% to 10%, and in census metropolitan areas where the unemployment is higher than 6%, there's a refusal to process in the low-wage stream. I've also undertaken over the next now 60 days to come back to you all with our plans on the high-wage stream. Donc, pour préciser en français, le premier ministre a indiqué en août, et les changements vont prendre effet le 26 septembre, que le pourcentage des effectifs qu'une entreprise peut avoir de travailleurs étrangers temporaires a diminué de 20% à 10%. Et dans les régions de recensement métropolitaine où le taux de chômage est plus que 6%, moi, je vais mettre en place, on va avoir en place un refus de traitement de ces demandes. Je confirme aujourd'hui que ce changement s'appliquera également au Québec, au programme de traitement simplifié, qui n'a actuellement pas de plafond. Today, I'm confirming that this change will also be applicable to the traitement simplifié in Québec, which currently does not have a cap limit. Nous avons également annoncé une réduction de la durée maximale de nouveaux permis de travail pour la catégorie de bas salaire, qui passerait de 2 années à 1 an. Cette mesure exclura les employeurs du secteur agricole primaire et inclura les permis de travail relevant au traitement simplifié au Québec. Enfin, je confirme également que la liste des régions métropolitaines de recensement soumises au processus de refus sera mise à jour tous les trimestres à l'aide des données les plus récentes sur le marché du travail afin de garantir qu'elles répondent aux besoins du Canada et qu'elles tiennent compte des taux de chômage régionaux. As I've said before, and I'm going to state it again, the temporary foreign worker program is an accordion. It's meant to flex with the economy. When we have a high number of vacancies, we can bring in more people, and as the economy tightens, we close the accordion and we make it harder for people to come in because Mark and I and our government want those jobs to go to Canadians. We want them to go to people who live here. We want them to go to students. We want them to go to newcomers. We want them to go to people who want to take those jobs. Point à la ligne. And so we're working hard every day to make sure there's more jobs for Canadians. We're seeing a slight increase in unemployment, which is a natural result of the high interest rates, which are also coming down. And now with inflation at 2% and having come down over 8 months, that's a critical piece to see a turn in the economy. And today we're making good on our promise to actually reduce the numbers in the temporary foreign worker program and to make sure that the program applies across the country. Merci beaucoup. And I'll turn now to my colleague, Mark Miller.
Thanks, Randy. Bonjour à tous. Merci, Randy, d'avoir mis la table pour tout le monde. Less than a year ago, we announced three big measures when it comes to international students. One, a national cap and a redistribution of the student permits out of a spirit of fairness across the provinces and territories. Two, a very important limitation on spousal permits. And three, as part of making sure that the system is dealing with the fraud that we had seen, a process of letter of acceptances that involves the provinces certifying that the institutions that students, international students, are coming into are indeed those that that we see on the applications. Those were very important. In addition to some of the measures that I announced in December with respect to the solvency requirements of students that have to come to Canada. Canada is not an inexpensive place to live in. And in addition to the work hour amendments that we have made that limit the work hours to 20 and now coming up 24 hours for students studying full time. We expect students to be doing exactly that. But let's set the table further a little. When you look at the growth that we have seen in people that are temporary residents of Canada, that's something that has grown almost exponentially over the last few years, from about 437,000 individuals in 2019 alone to about 1.2 million in 2023. That comes with consequences, but let's not also forget the importance that immigration generally, the importance of people that are here on a temporary basis, has done for the economy. The Bank of Canada has said it, the International Monetary Fund has said it, the immigration writ large has been in part responsible for preventing us from going into a recession, has been important for the net growth in the gross domestic product. Again, this has been important, and it's been important to the growth of the country, but I think it's safe to admit that we have allowed certain aspects of this to get overheated, and probably for too long. I made in March an announcement, an important one, to reduce the number of people that are here temporarily from 7% to 5% over the next 3 years. The Bank of Canada rightly highlighted that a number of the measures that we have taken, while important, were not sufficient in order to address that number and to give people the satisfaction that those numbers were going to come down in that period. Today, along with the announcements that Randy is making, we are announcing further measures, specifically, importantly, with respect to international students, and a few other ones that I will go through here shortly. First, I'd like to say that the measures that we've taken with respect to international students, and again, taking a step back, international students and the postgraduate work permits that come with it, occupy about 50% of the temporary workers that are here in Canada. The programs that Randy administers, about 10-15%, depending how you're counting. So the growth in the international student space, along with the postgraduate work permits that come with them, the spousal permits that come with them, are ones where we owe it to Canadians, and in the context of an economy where the labor market in some areas is constricting, we need to adjust accordingly. I would say that the measures that we've taken up to now are working. You have seen more than anecdotal evidence that there has been an impact on certain rental markets where students are more prevalent. And this is an announcement in advance of the annual level plan that I know a number of you are eager to hear me on, that I will be announcing on November 1st, and integrating for the first time ever a fuller picture of what immigration looks like in our country and what we are projecting for the economy, for Canada, for our social cohesion for the next 3 years. So today I am announcing six additional measures, and I'll go through them in a little bit of detail because I think that's important. Tout d'abord, nous allons réduire la cible des permis d'études délivrés de 10% en 2025 par rapport à 2024. Et nous maintiendrons ce niveau pour 2026. Cela signifie que nous visons à délivrer jusqu'à 437 000 permis d'études en 2025 et 2026, ce qui représenterait une baisse d'environ 36 % par rapport à 2023. Deuxièmement, nous allons exempter moins d'étudiants du plafond. Ça veut dire que les gens qui n'étaient pas partie du plafond qu'on avait annoncé en janvier, c'est-à-dire les gens qui étudient à la maîtrise ou au doctorat, vont être pris en ligne de compte dans ce calcul. For those of you that are looking at the numbers, you will see the number I announced is higher as part of the first measure I'm taking, and that's because of Measure 2, in which we are carving in master's and PhD programs. So simply put, the international student cap is here to stay. Certains étudiants étrangers sont mieux préparés pour s'intégrer et évidemment réussir au Canada, en particulier les étudiants qui sont titulaires de diplômes d'études supérieures. Ceci répond bien aux besoins du marché du travail canadien. C'est pourquoi nous réservons environ 12 % du plafond à ces étudiants et alignerons le programme de permis de travail de post-diplôme sur nos priorités économiques. Over the next 3 years, I think this is important, we expect these changes to yield approximately 300,000 fewer study permits. À partir du, ça c'est la troisième mesure, à partir du 1er novembre, nous instaurerons de nouvelles exigences en matière de capacité de compétences linguistiques pour les demandeurs de permis de travail post-diplôme alignés sur les exigences du volet de résidence permanente. A Canadian Language Benchmark, CLB, Level 7 for university graduates and CLB 5 for college graduates will be required for anyone applying for post-graduation work permit on or after November 1st of 2024. We know that people that can speak the language are better equipped to succeed in Canadian society. This is a more stringent requirement that I think is very important if we are going to continue the successful story of integration of some of these people into Canadian society. Fourth, for prospective students applying on or after November 1st, post-graduation work permit eligibility will depend on the level of study. Graduates from bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degree programs will remain eligible for a work permit up to 3 years. These graduates are more likely to acquire transferable knowledge and skills and be able to adapt to changing economic circumstances over the long term. Les diplômés des programmes des collèges publics, par contre, pourront obtenir un permis de travail pour une durée maximale de 3 ans seulement si leur domaine d'études est lié à des pénuries sur le marché du travail au Canada. Ces changements feront en sorte que les diplômés disposent de compétences et des occasions de travail nécessaires pour s'intégrer avec succès dans le marché du travail canadien et éventuellement faire la transition peut-être vers la résidence permanente. Over the next three years, we expect these changes to yield approximately 175,000 fewer postgraduate work permits. In the near future, we'll also take further measures to restrict eligibility to spousal open work permits. The fifth measure that I'm announcing today will be to further limit work permit eligibility to spouses of students in doctoral and certain master's select professional programs and certain pilot programs. And over the next 3 years, we expect that measure and these changes to yield approximately 50,000 fewer work permits for the spouses of students groups. And sixth, unrelated to students and postgraduate work permits, we'll also be limiting work permit eligibility to include only spouses of highly skilled, specialized workers such as C-suite executives, scientists, engineers, lawyers, professors, and technicians, or of workers in sectors where there are those key labor shortages. Spouses of workers in critical sectors like healthcare, construction will also obviously continue to be eligible for those work permits. As a quantitative measure, again, over the next 3 years, we expect these changes to yield approximately 100,000 fewer work permits. Again, I do stress that these are estimates and obviously will need to be tracked closely. Finalement, en conclusion, comme vous le savez, au cours des dernières années, le contexte en immigration a changé. Évidemment, il y a beaucoup de gens qui tentent et qui menacent d'exploiter, qui exploitent nos programmes d'immigration. À cette fin, j'ai demandé il y a plusieurs mois à mon sous-ministre d'examiner la façon dont les gens, les visas, qui donnent des visas, prennent des décisions dans ce nouveau contexte, y compris les outils, la formation, l'analyse et les procédures utilisées pour approuver les visas de résidents temporaires. En juin de cette année, après avoir discuté avec mes collègues des provinces, après nos discussions internes, j'ai demandé à mon département de scruter à la loupe cette prise de décision. Face au volume qui n'est pas soutenable de gens qui désirent venir au Canada, sachez que arriver au Canada, vouloir venir au Canada est peut-être un rêve, mais c'est un privilège et non un droit. Those measures that we have taken internally to be be a little more restrictive on who gets visas, looking at countries where we are seeing people exploiting the visa system, that is to say that those that are claiming for asylum are not legitimate asylum claimants, is a challenge to the system, particularly given the volume of people that are looking to come to Canada. Again, as I said in French, it is a privilege to come to Canada. It is not a right. If you compare the numbers of people that have come in, for example, in one country where we have had some of those challenges from India, we have seen those visas jump down from around 50,000 in January to less than 10,000 in August. Again, these are preliminary numbers, but it is an indicative sign that the measures that we have taken over the summer after discussions with my provincial colleagues are working. There's more work to do. And again, there are a number of measures that we need to take to make sure that when asylum seekers come to this country, they get due process, but that there is no abuse in the system. And it is incumbent on the federal government to act when it controls the levers, particularly at the border. I want to say one final word on what I believe to be, at least at the initial stages, a productive working group with a number of my colleague ministers of labor and immigration, skills training, depending on the title they hold in the province that they represent, over the course of the summer. At the Council of the Federation, all of the premiers got together and said that we needed to work as a group to deal with the asylum challenge that this country is facing and that a lot of countries in our position are facing, particularly with respect to the unsustainable numbers of asylum seekers coming into Quebec and coming in to Ontario. All premiers at that time agreed. As a parallel process, had already started the idea of a working group with my colleagues from the provinces to deal with this. We asked ourselves a fundamental question as part of our working group was, what does a fair asylum system look like? That started first and foremost with the responsibility of the federal government to make sure that we are doing our role when it comes to bringing and addressing the number of asylum seekers coming into the country, but also the roles of the provinces that have the effective jurisdiction on some of the services that these asylum seekers seek to do their part. And they all agreed to do so. And with the chairmanship of the Government of Canada and the Government of Nova Scotia, we worked throughout the summer to look at different models of what could this system look like. I'm taking a little bit of time to give you some background because I currently no longer think that working group is actually helpful. I don't blame the bureaucrats in question. I don't blame the civil servants of our respective provinces and territories for having done their work. I don't blame my colleague ministers for putting their hearts into it. There was a lot of good faith at that table. But sadly, three particularly conservative ministers have stood up, the premiers of Nova Scotia, of New Brunswick and Alberta, and decided to weaponize this working group. They took a theoretical number of asylum seekers based on the last year's number of asylum seekers, divided it up by the population as they would, and assumed that the federal government would impose a number of asylum seekers on them. Let me restate, Ontario and Quebec are doing more than their fair share, and the other provinces need to step up. But there was no point in time where anyone said that the federal government was going to impose thousands of asylum seekers on unprepared provinces. I should probably give you the documents that they themselves leaked because it would probably be quite helpful for your analysis. But this was a productive working group that has been weaponized by three premiers in particular for their re-election or their leadership review, and I think it's really irresponsible. Those provinces come knocking at my door for more immigrants. They are responsible for about 20% of permanent residency numbers through the provincial nominee program. Quebec has the entire control over its permanent residency program based on the Quebec-Canada Accord. And there is a responsible way of doing things. This was not responsible, and they threw their own ministers under the bus, and they've made this productive working group much less productive. It doesn't mean we're giving up. I question the pertinence of this group, given the fact that the documents have been leaked. It's unfortunate, but I do think there was good faith around the table, and we can work on an individual
basis with these provinces to see which ones will stand up. There's money on the table. There's over $1 billion that we've committed to making sure that we have a system that makes sense. There are countries in Europe that have a system that makes sense. And indeed, the European Union has a system that, while they are facing different challenges than us, at least has some semblance of sense. So this is about a bunch of premiers who decided to weaponize the issue. Unfortunately, it's undermined the credibility of this committee and obviously considering dissolving it.
Has been produced by Depictions Media. Please contact us at depictions.media for more information.